Hi everyone, my name is Theodor Mitev, and in this lecture titled A Global Nervous System from the Telegraph to Cyberspace, I want to discuss the origins of global information networks, the invention of the telegraph, the ways in which the telegraph revolutionized how we understand reality, and how we approach materiality, as well as the media paradigm that came into being with the arrival of the telegraph and the wiring of the globe. I also focus on the metaphors and conceptualizations of this new world that came with the spread of the telegraph and on the ways our ancestors were trying to grapple with the dramatic disruption and change of their world, because these ways ended up informing the cultural tropes that we use today to think about the world and the information networks we inhabit. So we'll discuss the idea of information networks spanning the globe as the nervous system of materiality. The idea that information can travel independently from materiality, which used to carry it before. The idea of immediacy, of real time. We will talk also about the appearance of thinking machines and their role in the spread of these information networks, as well as the rise of the dominant information network we know today, the internet. So the starting point for this lecture is the time just before the appearance of global information networks. And to think about the importance of the telegraph and the first information networks to span the globe, to think about this properly, it's really important to understand what communication across distance meant until the mid-19th century, until the appearance of the telegraph, what it meant for the entirety of history of humanity until that moment, for countless millennia, as it were. Before the telegraph, to send a message across a distance, you had to move matter carrying that message, right? So in order to send a piece of information from point A to point B in space, you had to move through space and time something material carrying that information, right? So you could walk carrying that message, you could get on a horse carrying that message a little bit faster over space and time, you could get on a coach to travel a little bit more comfortably, but again with the speed of a horse, over space and time. Information meant matter, right? There was no, the notion of information as separate from matter was unthinkable. It did not exist. The notion of a message as such always involved some sort of material medium, material carrier. And I underscore material because it's really important to understand the role of the limitations of space and time in communication technologies and in the communicative act as such on its own. The prison of space, as it were. So these are the limitations of distance and duration imposed on us by the physics of this universe, right? So these are non-negotiable limitations. And up until the mid-19th century, the fastest way we could send information over a distance, the fastest way we could communicate from point A to point B over distance, was with a train. And which in and of itself was quite much faster than walking or sailing or a horse ride, but still immensely slow and still a subject to the prison of space. Of course, there were other ways of communicating as well. So you had smoke signals. You had an early 19th century invention called the semaphore, which relied on light signals. The problem with those was that they relied on line of sight. The point being that you had to stand at a certain distance and observe directly in a straight line that signal, right? So they were as well immensely slow, and they still were subject to that prison of space. They still relied on matter being carried across in one way or another. They were not efficient in any way. And then something happened. And that something was the invention of electricity, the discovery of electromagnetic current, the description of its laws by Maxwell in the early 19th century, and then the telegraph arriving. And here we have a fantastic quote by Nathaniel Hawthorne from his book The House of Seven Gables. This is exactly the middle of the 19th century. And for those of you who do not know, Nathaniel Hawthorne is a famous romantic poet. And in this quote, he is grappling with this dramatic new technology, revolutionary, highly disruptive, highly troubling new technology. So what is Hawthorne saying? Is it a fact or have I dreamt it? Right? It's almost like a dream that by means of electricity, the world of matter has become a great nerve, vibrating thousands of miles in a breathless point of time. Rather, the round globe is a vast head, a brain, instinct with intelligence. Or shall we say, it is itself a thought, nothing but thought, and no longer the substance which we deemed it. No longer the substance. So something very strange has happened to the material world. Right? And Hawthorne is trying to grapple with this. This is the world that our ancestors inhabited for millennia beforehand. Suddenly, thoughts, right, the very thought, can travel across thousands of miles instantly in a breathless point of time. So it's really hard to imagine this reality before, for the reality which these people inhabited, which was still the reality of a world before the arrival of instantaneous communication. And what you see here is, in this quote, really captures the dramatic nature of this change occurring, because we have people struggling with the notion that they can observe and participate in something which occurs somewhere else, remotely, over a great distance. Right? You have the disappearance of now. And that the essence of this change is the fact that information as such, in and of itself, absent any material medium carrying it, can now travel over great distances in real time, as it were. And what is connected with that change is the revolutionary new technology of the telegraph. The telegraph is the product of that experimentation in the early 19th century with the, at that time, almost mystical force of electromagnetism. So electromagnetism actually was often used in what were then very popular occult seances, where people would try and talk to ghosts and things like that, because it was associated as something almost magical, almost mystical. Why? Because it's invisible yet acts on the world. Right? So its invisibility, its immateriality rendered it almost mystical. And then the telegraph comes in as the ability to harness this mystical force, electromagnetism, in order to transmit information over a great distance, absent matter. And in that context, the telegraph, writ large, as an innovation and as a technology which disrupts and changes the world, is probably the most revolutionary technology we have ever invented as a species. One could argue that in many ways we still live in the telegraph age, not in the internet age or any other age, because it changed profoundly the world. The first telegraph that was used commercially appeared in 1837, but it was a faulty technology because it relied on a very complex encoding of characters. Basically, it tried to transmit messages which encoded each character as an individual letter belonging to a very complex alphabet. And it was a faulty technology. It could not spread properly. It could not be used easily by people. Operators of that first telegraph could not be easily trained. So it died a natural death of early innovation. And its appearance was followed by an invention by a man called Samuel Morse. So Samuel Morse is a fascinating character. He was a painter. And his story is really interesting and sad at the same time, because he was hired by the United States Congress. He was an American. He was hired by Congress to paint a portrait of the French general Lafayette, who participated in the US Revolutionary War. And while painting that portrait, he received a letter from home by a horse courier, naturally, that his wife was sick. So he dropped everything and went on a coach to reach her. But by the time he went back, she had already passed away and was already buried, in fact. So this dramatic fact forced him to dedicate his life to invent a method for fast communication. And in 1838, so 1 year after the first deployment of a commercial telegraph, he demonstrated a radically different way for a long-distance communication with a telegraph, using what was at that time called a dot-dash code, and what now we call universally the Morse code, after his name. So what was so special about his invention, and what was so revolutionary about it? Instead of trying to encode all possible alphabetical characters or words or letters, digits, etc., with individual electromagnetic symbols, he did the reverse. In fact, he invented an alphabet for representing all possible characters with only two electromagnetic symbols, a dot and a dash, as it was then called, which actually corresponded to the two possible states of the electromagnetic circuit that you can see on this slide. The circuit is either open or closed, right? It's a binary state. So by clicking or pressing on the telegraph lever, the operator either closed or opens the circuit, doing either a dot or a dash, and combinations of those actually were used to represent, and to this day actually used to represent, all possible characters. And because of the ease of operating the telegraph equipment, given this encoding and the ease of training operators, as it were, the telegraph spread like wildfire. This was a fresh technology, and fascinating to everyone, because again of its mysterious associations with electromagnetism. And what happens is an immediate push and campaign, as it were, to connect geographic locations through cable. So we have the first undersea cable already in 1851 across the English Channel, connecting Europe and England and the United Kingdom with a cable allowing instantaneous communication via telegraph. Right, very important point. The telegraph is cutting edge. It's sexy. You know, people take pictures with the telegraph as a fascinating new technology. In 1858, so 7 years after the first undersea cable connecting England and Europe, we have the first transatlantic cable connecting England and North America. And this is a faulty cable because it's the speed of transmission is quite slow. It's 2 minutes per character, right? So think of the speed in the context of the how fast it takes to type a dot and a dash, and think of the fact that it took 2 minutes to transmit that communication over the channel. But just a few years later, we have the first proper transatlantic cable with much faster speed of transition. And it took minutes only to send complex messages. The thing to think about here when it comes to the context of this happening is that until that point, the speed of communication across the Atlantic was immeasurably slower, right? So the fastest possible way to send a message from, let's say, England to the United States before that transatlantic cable was laid would involve, you know, the fastest possible ship with the fastest possible crew. It would take at least 10 days, depending on weather and time of the year, to carry that message across, right? So, and here we are talking about minutes. So this is a paradigmatic change in communication and in the way these countries and different places in the world start thinking about each other and relaying to one another. And initially, this is not technology for ordinary people, obviously. This is technology only for heads of state, only for the elites and for very large corporations. The first transatlantic cable has a speed of 8 words per minute. The original rate is $100 of this is of that time, right? 1866 for a message of 10 words, and this was the minimum message that could be sent. And this is pretty much, depending on how you calculate inflation, I've calculated versus the price of gold in 1866 and now in 2020, this pretty much would cost around $10,000 in today's currency. So think of that price in the context of other prices today. And this is how much the simplest possible message cost at that time. This leads to the first radio telegraph, which is a telegraph without wires, as it were, right? Telegraphic messages being sent through radio waves using the dot dash signal, and down the track to the invention of the radio. And if we take a step back from this pace of innovations, the first thing to notice is that the telegraph causes a profound shift in the way people saw the world and were thinking of themselves in the world. And to understand it, the real importance of the telegraph and the changes it wrought in reality, we need to understand the dramatic change in world perception. And what's at stake here is the separation of information from matter, right? That's the crux of what is happening. So how does the telegraph work, actually? Right, so you have a message. Let's say you go to a telegraph office and over there you fill a form with your message and you write it precisely. The telegraph operator takes that form, sends the message by typing on the telegraph using the Morse code, and then presumably you pay for that service, and the message has been sent. The message is received at the destination where you sent it. It's transcribed back from Morse code to to a form and then sent to the destination, to the person that you actually intended it for. And there are a number of very interesting anecdotes from that time. So for example, there's this person in Baltimore in the United States who wants to send a message in Boston. This is the first years of the telegraph. And so he goes to the office and writes down his message on a form and gives it to the operator. The operator types it using Morse code, sends it. And then the practice was at that time that you take the message once it's sent, right? You take the form and hang it on a hook somewhere in the office, where you did basically a simple system of keeping track of messages that were already sent. The person who actually sent the message was left speechless though, and approached the operator and asked, "Wait a minute, why didn't you send my message? I paid for it, why haven't you sent it? You've charged me, but the message is still here." And so the operator had to really struggle to explain that the message physically might be here, but its information quotient has been sent across the wires, right? The nerves of iron wire spanning the globe. And that's what's at stake here, right? The physical aspect of the medium carrying that message remains, but the information quotient of that message has been decoupled from it and sent somewhere else. And this was what people really struggled with to understand. Another great example is from 1870, from the Franco-Prussian War. So at that time, the telegraph is already a mature technology, and there was this German mother who goes to the telegraph office to send a message to her son who is on the front. And so she writes him a message, and the message is standard, take care, watch yourself, and eat your soup. And then she brings a jar of soup to the office. And so the telegrapher sends the message, and the mother says, "Okay, but what about the soup?" And again, we have the same problem. Because the mother struggles to understand, you managed to send the message that I wrote, and it was physical, why couldn't you send the soup the same way? What about the soup? And this is what is really at stake here. The fact that you have information separating from matter. And it's really important that you understand the profound revolutionary happening that this actually portends. Here we have the New York Tribune from 1845. It is now almost certain that within a few months, the magnetic telegraph, which is literally thought and flies a swift, absolutely annihilating space and running in advance of time, will extend to all the great cities of the Union, so that a network of nerves of iron wire, strung lightning, will ramify from the brain, New York, to the distant limbs and members, to the Atlantic seaboard towns, Pittsburgh, Cincinnati, Louisville, Nashville, St. Louis, New Orleans, and that every commercial, political, or social event transpiring at either of these points will be at the very instant it happens in all. So, look at what's happening here. We have the appearance of the notion of the network. We have the notion of an information network as nerves of virus, iron wire, information network acting as a nervous system. We have this imperialist imaginary of the world, as it were, where suddenly we have the world transitioning into a body, and its brain here is New York or other important capitals, London, Paris, etc. And its distant limbs and members are the peripheral cities, which are now controlled from the center using this network of nerves of iron wire. Right, so any space spanned by these networks of iron wire is a space to be controlled, and control and coordination appear as issues of fundamental importance. And notice I've isolated here key elements from this quote because it's a fascinating and very insightful quote. So notice, first we have this idea of literally thought, and this is what they mean by this is what they express as information. And they're trying to describe information here, literally thought. Annihilating space and running in advance of time, right? The compression and elimination of the prison of space. A network of nerves of iron wire. So the ability to command and coordinate and control at a distance, because this is what nerves do in the body. And the notion of instantaneity, the notion of now, the notion of real time. These are these nerves of iron wire. You can see them on this slide. So this is Manhattan in 1887, right? So streets are literally crisscrossed by these thousands and thousands of nerves of iron wire connecting different offices, corporations, small businesses, houses even, right? Sending and transmitting messages. The world becomes a body. The notion of control over that body, over that inert mass, suddenly. So the notion of a materiality which can be coordinated and controlled and commanded at a distance emerges, right? So these are fundamental tropes which will stay with us until today, right? Which appeared with the telegraph, hence why we, in many respects, still live in the telegraph age. The centers of that body are the capitals of global empire, naturally, and what's at stake is coordination and control. And what brings this forward is that decoupling of information from matter. All right, so let's try and summarize what we've discovered so far when it comes to the telegraph. We have information being decoupled from matter, and this is a phenomenon of profound earth-shattering importance. We have the simultaneous appearing of the phenomenon of compression of space-time, where information can travel over great distances in practically real time. As a result, we have the appearance of a global information network allowing the sending of messages and receiving of messages across fantastic, until that point, distances. Therefore, the appearance of coordination, communication, and control over great distances. And we have that notion of the real time becoming the dominant, as it were, notion, because once a powerful organization such as a corporation or a state encounters the ability to practice coordination and control over vast distances in real time, everything changes. So now let us try and map these changes and try and understand how to a certain extent only, how they actually percolated through the imaginary of people and through their daily practices. And our starting point is this notion of the obliteration of distance, the obliteration of time and space, which is concomitant obviously with the decoupling of information from matter. The immediate result is that now that communication over distance in real time has become possible, and that because of the ubiquity of the technology and the low cost of training and deployment of the technology, the dramatically falling cost, suddenly people become interested in the distant. Suddenly far off places start being thought of as our places, or places that belong to our world, our knowable world, as it were. So the news appears, and here you have on the slide, you know, the phenomenon of newspapers such as the Evening Telegraph, or the Daily Telegraph, or the Morning Telegraph, etc., etc. Telegraph, doesn't really matter how it was named. The point is that these are aggregators of news from around the world received via this new and exciting technology. So until the telegraph as such appeared, news as we know it today operated very differently, right? So it was available to, and interesting to, for that matter, only the elites. For everyone else, the entirety of their living experience was from their immediate locality. Only the most powerful elites could afford to maintain a courier system for fast information exchanges over a great distance. Right? All other news was actually local, because it was very expensive to transmit news over a great distance. And that news was obviously never real time. To give you an example, and this is a 19th century example from the Battle of Waterloo, 1815, where Napoleon fought against an alliance of European powers, the last great battle of Napoleon, and Napoleon was defeated. A very powerful banker at the time, Baron de Rothschild, had his own courier service, his own private courier service, and he received news of the battle in which England participated. The Duke of Wellington was the commander of the Allied forces fighting against Napoleon. Rothschild received the news of the battle 24 hours before everyone else received it, through his private courier service. And so he was able to spread rumors immediately on the London Stock Exchange that the battle had been lost, which immediately caused the dramatic fall of prices of the United Kingdom government's bonds. And Rothschild immediately bought all of these bonds for a very low cost. And when the news of the battle and the victory finally arrived to everyone, His holdings and financial power increased exponentially. The point here is that access to real-time information did not exist. And the closer one wanted to be to real-time, the more one had to pay. So only the elites could be or try to be close to real-time, and even that involved only very short distances, right? If you are operating over, let's say, continental distances, there was no such thing as real time. All information traveled at least a week. So the arrival of the telegraph completely changes that reality. So we have the appearance of information aggregators. Here, and what we see in this picture, you know, you can see the blackboards and something is being written on them. So here, you have an information aggregator, the Evening Telegraph, telling you what is happening right now, right? At this very moment, this very evening, presumably, across the world. All sorts of real-time events start becoming possible. So the act of following events in real time, the act of, for example, trading information, trading on a stock exchange in real time, becomes possible. Mass culture appears because it relies on real-time participation of the distributed masses in localized events, right? For example, sports. Here you have telegraph operators at a baseball game in Philadelphia in 1913, right? So they're furiously tapping away dots and dashes, reporting on what is happening on the field to presumably hundreds of thousands of millions of people participating in that event in real time across and distributed across the vast space of the United States. Moreover, the weather is as a concept appears. Until the telegraph, you could not really follow the weather as such. You could only observe your local weather. If you were living in England, let's say in London, you couldn't know what is the weather right now in Newcastle, for example. Because by the time someone came to tell you from Newcastle what is the weather over there, obviously by that time the weather would have changed many times over, right? So now suddenly all of this can be observed in real time. All of this information can be collected in a centralized point, can be processed. Patterns emerge because of that real-time observation. Patterns which would have been impossible to notice beforehand. So weather observation and prediction becomes possible. This is really important to remember, and we will return to this point when we talk about internet surveillance down the track in this cycle of lectures. Because the weather can be predicted now. You can follow the movement of storms and cyclones and cloud formations across space and time and predict patterns based on that. As an effect, you have as Manuel Castells, a fascinating media theorist specializing in the appearance of the information society, as he points out, you have the information networks annihilating, as it were, space and time at the same time. And you can see in this ad for a telegraph company, you can the kind of messages that can be sent across the globe. Day telegrams, night telegrams, money transfers become possible, direct cables to Europe, Asia, Cuba, base connections with all other foreign points. You have the appearance of massification because you don't even have to go to the telegraph office anymore, right? You can call a messenger send a message that way, or you can go to the telegraph office, send a message, and then that message will be taken by a telegraph messenger and delivered in person to your destination, right? At the other end of the globe. More importantly, we have the appearance of time as such. And this is a really strange problem to think of, and a really strange thing to say, because one would think that time exists independently from this kind of technological innovations. But that is not so, because until the arrival of the telegraph and the ability to think about events happening simultaneously and being observed simultaneously from the other end of the world, one's experience of reality was always already localized, which in effect necessitated the existence of only local time. Now, for the first time, the ability to communicate across the globe simultaneously in real time necessitated a standardization of time. Because for the first time you had the real time instantaneous observation that it's morning in Berlin but it's still night in London, for example. So we had the necessity for the standardization of time zones. And this is one of the great diplomatic battles of the late 19th century, the battle over establishing and charting the precise time zones, and the battle over where the zero meridian would be, where time zero would be, right? The center for the time zones of the world. As it happened, it was at the end decided that it would be located in Greenwich in Great Britain, which was, of course, because Great Britain was the largest and most powerful empire on the globe at that time. So we have the appearance of global time. And as the New York Herald declares at around that time, the end of the 19th century, it requires no small intellectual effort to realize that this is a fact that now is, and not one that has been, the idea of instantaneity, of real time. of observing something over a great distance as it unfolds. The idea of being in the now, across space. This is a breathtaking experience, actually. An experience we really struggle to comprehend due to the fact that we were born already in an environment profoundly permitted by this new technology. But here, for example, we have the New York Times from 1858 trying to tackle what these changes mean, actually. So far as the influence of the newspaper upon the mind and morals of the people is concerned, there can be no rational doubt that the telegraph has caused vast injury. Superficial, sudden, unsifted, too fast for the truth, must be all telegraphic intelligence. Does it not render the popular mind too fast for the truth? 10 days brings us the mail from Europe. What need is there for the scraps of news in 10 minutes? How trivial and paltry is the telegraphic column? It snowed here, it rained there, one man killed, another hanged. Even the Washington letter has deteriorated since the innovation. And I can conscientiously recommend my own epistles prior to 1844 in preference to those of later years. Superficial, sudden, unsifted, too fast for the truth. Right? It's too fast. Like, you have this exclamation captures so much, right? The access to all of this avalanche of information suddenly appearing from all over the place overwhelms the senses. It kills off reflexivity. There is no time to reflect and think on the change because so much more new information appears. Hence, it's too fast for the truth. What need is there for the scraps of news in 10 minutes? Think of this reaction from 1858 and compare it to reaction to Twitter, for example, and to the reaction to social media updates and how critics of social media think about this phenomenon. You will find a lot in common because the fundamental tropes here are identical. What we have here, and we will return to these tropes again and again, is the extraction of information from matter and extraction of duration from space. There's no duration anymore, right? Because you can, in practice, cross space instantly. Like nothing but thought, right? Pure thought, as someone exclaimed. Nerves of iron wire. Like the world of matter has become a great nerve, vibrating thousands of miles in a breathless point of time. Everything happens in a breathless point of time for the first time. Everything happens now, simultaneously. They're too fast for the truth. The world, a single body, in a breathless point of time. Wires and cables, its nervous system. And this is how this world actually looks in practice at that time, right? So this is the world in 1900, the break of the 20th century, spanned by nerves of iron wire. You can see here the spread of submarine telegraph cables, undersea telegraph cables spread across the globe, spanning across Eurasia, spanning across the Atlantic, crossing the Indian Ocean, connecting all continents together in one body. And you can see just from this distance by the thickness of the connections where the center of that nervous system is. Right? You can see how everything, all lines lead to London, where the center of that global communication network resides, right? At the center of the British Empire. Simultaneously with the telegraph, innovations related to it in one way or another start emerging. Right? The first and very important of those is the telephone, right? Which obviously uses telegraph wires for its communication. So the first telephone patented in 1876 by Alexander Bell, the first telephone communication on the 10th of March of that year is from Alexander Bell to his assistant, Mr. Watson, come here, I want to see you. And this phrase for me captures so much because it's a perfect illustration of this notion of these tropes of command and control appearing, right? So we have communication over distance in effect being boiled down to two fundamental tropes, the ability to coordinate over distance and therefore command and control. The arrival of the telephone and the rapid spread of the telegraph and telephone simultaneously, telephone using telegraph networks, telegraph wires literally, leads to the emergence of a very interesting phenomenon, the so-called telephone girls. Initially, telegraph offices are staffed by, and they have to be staffed by very well-trained operators who know Morse code. But telephone offices have to be staffed by switchboard operators, and you can see a switchboard on the slide, right? Because how these telephone communications look like is that someone has a telephone in their office or home, and they lift the handle of the telephone and they speak directly to an operator and they tell them the number they need to connect to, and the operator manually using that switchboard connects them to that number, in which case we have the closure of an electric circuit and a ring on the other end of the line and a possible communication appearing if someone picks the phone. And initially the telephone switchboard operators were young boys because they were presumed to be very nimble and able to operate the wires, and obviously because they were also very cheap to pay for the companies which were operating these telephone networks. However, this proved to be a poor choice because they were playing pranks on customers, they were impatient, they were crossing the wires too much. So very soon after that, women ended up being exclusively employed as telephone operators, and they were known as the telephone girls. And in fact, this became one of the first industries in which women were able to gain employment. And here we have an example of the New York Telephone Company hiring qualifications for telephone operators. Every girl should be in good health, quick-handed, clear-voiced, and with a certain poise and alertness of manner. Here we have an example of a telephone switchboard in Virginia, 1884. You can see how you have the different wires that have to be crossed, and the switchboard operators are waiting for new calls, which they will have to manually switch. So what is actually happening here, if you abstract from the physicality of that experience, is operators managing information flows. Because each of these wires that have to be switched and connected represents a separate information flow which has to be processed and managed, as it were, by the operator. And this is a very important trope to which we will return down the track in another lecture, the notion of sorting through information flows and processing them and managing them, right? So the telephone girls were in many respects the pioneers of that phenomenon of sorting through information at scale, as it were. Something else happens, a dramatic change appears, because the appearance of the telephone as a technology, and the telegraph for that matter, makes possible a completely new type of architecture, a completely new type of city to emerge. They make possible the skyscraper. Without the telephone and the telegraph, the skyscraper is impossible. Simply because if you were to wanted to send a message across different offices in a, let's say, 50-story building, without a telephone or a telegraph, that would be literally physically impossible. Whoever you employed to run around the floors and send messages will give up after the first few days. So these technologies make possible a new type of building, new type of architecture, a new type of urban management, a new type of urban organization. Concomitantly, the radio appears in 1895, so it was initially known as the radio telegraph. And initially it was used only to transmit telegraph messages, but later with the popularization of radio receivers, it was became popularized as a mass broadcasting and entertainment medium, and broadcast media to the masses as such was born. The radio is also connected to the invention of the living room, because up until then there was no way where you could receive communication remotely and have that experience of the entire family sitting together and participating in some sort of entertainment broadcast remotely. The radio allowed that to appear for the first time, later to be displaced by the television, obviously. So the radio is a communication technology of profound importance. We will return to it. The important thing here is that it was immediately adopted by the military with dramatic consequences, and companies started already thinking about portability, about making the radio a mobile experience, something that could be carried to the body. And this should be something familiar to all of you, because all of us now carry a communication device attached to our body. And it was followed by the invention of television, and the modern age as such appeared. The final point here that I want to stop on when it comes to this section of this lecture, too fast for the truth, is the emergence of the first radio satellites. So the first satellite ever was Sputnik 1, which was shot into space by the Soviet Union in 1957. And Sputnik 1 used a carrier rocket designed to carry intercontinental ballistic missiles with nuclear warheads, and it had a profound impact on contemporary strategic thinking and profound impact on the history of technological development, as we will discover in a second in this lecture. It was a bifurcation point when it comes to the development of technology. But before we continue in that direction, we need to take a step back. In fact, we need to rewind back to the beginning of the 19th century and examine the phenomenon of what ended up being known as thinking machines. So our starting point is British mathematician Charles Babbage, who theorized and drew the plans for what we now call the first computer, which he called the analytical engine. He never managed to build it, he ran out of funds, but it was recently reconstructed using, or rather constructed using his plans, and proven to work. So his plans were correct. And what's important about the analytical engine is that it was a machine that was able to calculate from inputs and provide an output. And the inputs were, the programs as it were to be encoded on paper punch cards. And this is important because up until that moment, paper punch cards were being used by weavers in their machines in order to set up the weaving program for a specific weaving operation. And the idea of using these paper punch cards that originated from weavers in an analytical engine came from Countess Ada Lovelace, the daughter of Lord Byron, the greatest romantic poet perhaps, who was also the person to write the first program for the analytical engine on those paper punch cards. And in that respect, Countess Ada Lovelace is literally the first programmer, the first computer programmer. She has the honor of being the person to invent computer programming as such. And even though their invention didn't go anywhere because they couldn't afford to build the analytical engine, that idea percolated. And specifically the idea of using paper punch cards to encode programs. And it was picked up by Hermann Hollerith, who in 1896 founded the tabulating machine company, which we now know as IBM, one of the giants of the computer industry, a legendary corporation associated with the history of computing. And on this image, you can see Hollerith's tabulating machine using those paper punch cards, which you can see stacked on top of it. What this development leads to is a really interesting realization, because the emergence of the global information networks made possible by the telegraph led to an explosion in communication. And the explosion of communication, in turn, the explosion of information transmission over distance, led to the industrialization of that transmission and the processing and storage of that information. And if you have been paying attention until now, you would have noticed that because of the association of command, coordination, and control with those global information networks, it became of paramount importance for the powers that be, for the elites of that time and the times to follow, to control the information flows and to control information transmission and processing, as it were. So we notice the immediate emergence of what one could call the game of secrets beginning, right? The need to hide information, the need to protect it, the need to secure it from prying eyes. We have the appearance of industrial encryption. And what you see on the slide is one of the most popular early 20th century encryption machines, known as the Enigma machine. So it had two varieties, a civilian one for civilian use by corporations and banks and governments, and then a military one for use by governments and especially the military, the German military, in the case of the Enigma machine. So why did the military make use of this kind of encryption machines? First and foremost, because they needed the ability to protect their own information channels. And the more modern militaries started deploying telegraph communication, which they started deploying immediately, and later radio communication, the more the need to protect the contents of the information transmission became possible. With telegraph, one still relied on the fact that in order to listen to the communication, someone had to be literally physically connected to the wire over which that communication was being transmitted. Not so with radio, because everyone with a receiver can detect a message which is beamed through radio waves. So with the deployment of radio, first in the First World War and especially in the Second World War, in the 20th century, the need to encrypt and protect information became paramount. And here we have the use of the Enigma machine by the Wehrmacht, by the German army in the Second World War. The German army, and we will return to this in another lecture, made extensive use of the radio. It was the first army to deploy the radio at scale. In all units, they were using the radio in individual tanks, for example, allowing individual tank commanders to communicate with each other and with command, thereby allowing command and control in real time over great distance of the army as it was encountering the enemy. And this in turn necessitated the encryption of these messages. So here you have an example of General Heinz Guderian, who commanded the German army during its breakthrough in the Western Front against France and England, using the Enigma in France in May 1940. You can see the operator is encrypting a message or decrypting a message. The reason why I'm spending so much time talking about encryption in the context of information networks and in the context of the rise of thinking machines is that, first, for communication, control, and coordination over distance to be successful in adverse scenarios, the information content has to be protected. But second, because the history of computing and the history of the internet is inextricably tied to these troubled times in the Second World War, which involved the story of the Enigma and the story of the information which the Enigma encrypted and the people who broke the Enigma in order to reach that information. And the primary protagonist in this story is Alan Turing, who can be rightfully considered the father of computing and artificial intelligence. In many respects, he could be considered the patron saint of all cryptanalysts and of all hackers, for that matter. Alan Turing is a titan of history. He had a profound role as a mathematician in the British effort in the in 1940, 1941, 1942 to break the encrypted traffic of Enigma communication that was being used by the German army, the Wehrmacht, the German Air Force, the Luftwaffe, and the German Navy, the Kriegsmarine, to communicate. So Alan Turing's effort produced, in collaboration with a number of other mathematicians and engineers, produced a machine which he called the Bombe, which was able to replicate the operation of the Enigma in reverse, as it were, and was able to therefore decrypt the messages that German commanders were encrypting via the Enigma. And this effort was industrialized to such an extent at Bletchley Park that British commanders and the general staff of the Allied forces was able to receive encrypted communications from German general command before German generals themselves were able to receive them, right? So the Allies had a complete overview over the internal communications of their enemy in real time as they were unfolding. Alan Turing's achievements, however, not at all limited to his contribution to the war effort in the Second World War. His great contributions start earlier than that. They start with his concept of a universal machine, which we now call the Universal Turing Machine, honoring his name. So in the Universal Machine, Turing in 1936 conceptualized for the first time the universal state computer, as it were. In that sense, any computer existing today, literally without exception, the computer on which you're watching this lecture, the computer in your phone, or wherever you might look, is a version, an instantiation, to a limited extent, of the Universal Turing Machine. So the Universal Turing Machine, the way Alan Turing imagined it, and described it in detail, was a conceptual apparatus which consisted of a tape which had an input It had a reader which was able to read that input, consisting of initially of a program with instructions on how to read itself, then the input as such, and then a calculation which was written on the tape as well, and in turn, and finally an output with the result of the calculation. So this was a reflexive machine, as it were, which was able to continuously read itself, perform a calculation, perform an output, and store it in memory in itself. I already mentioned Turing's contribution to cryptography. He was obviously tremendously influential when it comes to programming and early computers. But his other great contribution is in the field of artificial intelligence and the conceptualization of thinking machines. So after the war, his contribution in the war effort was top secret, so he was not able to share it in any way with anyone. But he wrote a tremendously influential paper, which I highly recommend everyone reads. It's called Computing Machinery and Intelligence. And this paper starts with this statement: I propose to consider the question, can machines think? It's a brilliant paper, probably one of the best academic papers ever written. And in this paper, Alan Turing actually proposed and described in detail what we now know as the Turing test, which is a game designed to detect a thinking machine, a game designed to detect a computer or any sort of machine that actually can be said to think. It's a fascinating paper, I highly recommend it. Simultaneously with Alan Turing, we have another great mathematician working this time in the States. His name is Vannevar Bush. He, while Turing was working on the war effort in England, at Bletchley Park, decrypting German communications, Vannevar Bush was one of the chief architects of the of US Strategic Command when it came to the use of computing, and also when it came to the design and development of nuclear weapons. He was heavily involved in the Manhattan Project. And in 1945, before the war had actually even ended in the Pacific, because it ended in Germany in May 1945, but in July, when he published As We May Think, it was still ongoing in the Pacific. He publishes this piece in the Atlantic called As We May Think. And this is in many respects, of almost fantastic in its implications, speculative article, comparable only to Alan Turing's article from 1950. And in it, Vannevar Bush says the following. In many respects, this is a condensation of the entire piece, which is highly fascinating. I recommend everyone reads it. Consider a future device for individual use, which is a sort of mechanized private file and library. It needs a name, and to coin one at random, Mimex will do. A Mimex is a device in which an individual stores all his books, records and communications, and which is mechanized so that it may be consulted with exceeding speed and flexibility. It is an enlarged, intimate supplement to his memory. So he theorizes this device, a Mimex, which stores memories and is able to do mathematical operations on them, to process them. It does what he terms associative indexing. Any item may be caused at will to select immediately and automatically another. This is the essential feature of the Mimex. The process of tying two items together is the important thing, right? So it's a machine which is able to understand the information stored in it and tie it together to process it. Wholly new forms of encyclopedias will appear, ready-made with a mesh of associative trails running through them, ready to be dropped into the Mimex and there amplified. So what we have here when it comes to these two great thinkers, Turing and Vannevar Bush, is immediately after the Second World War, or literally in the dying moments of the Second World War, we have imaginaries emerging of a future in which we have, on the one hand, thinking machines, and on the other hand, machines which are able to perform through human memories and to generate meshes of associative trails, new forms of encyclopedias. And following that, we are returning to the bifurcation point. So we have the emergence of global information networks in the mid-19th century. We have the rise of the radio, which allows communication over distance without wires even. We have the rise of computing machines. We have the rise of cryptography and counter-cryptography. We have first speculative imaginaries of thinking machines emerging. And the first satellite is shot into space in 1957. Why is this a bifurcation point? Because with this effort, the Soviet Union proved to the collective West, as it were, that it has the power to destroy command and control centers at will. Because again, the rocket which was used to shoot the satellite into space was a rocket designed to carry intercontinental ballistic missiles, able to be shot across continents and destroy via nuclear warheads any command and control center. And for a civilization which had already for 100 years since the arrival of the telegraph been organizing itself around centers of command and control, able to leverage these nerves of iron wire spanning the globe, this was a catastrophic event. Literally a catastrophic event, which necessitated a dramatic change in thinking about these nerves of iron wire, about these networks of coordination and control. And this brings us to the final piece of the lecture, which is the emergence of the network, as we call it, or the internet. And the internet's emergence is tied inextricably to the Sputnik, the first satellite, and to the figure of Paul Baran, who, together with a number of other strategic thinkers across the Western world, was tasked with thinking about ways to deal with the implications of what had just happened. And in 1964, he wrote a paper for the RAND Corporation, in which he proposed a completely new type of communication network, which he called ARPANET. And the concept for that network was a reaction to the danger that was being posed to these nerves of iron wire, the networks of coordination and control spanning the globe. So the network that he proposed had no central hub, right? So there was no center to be destroyed. It was designed to operate while broken. So it presumed from the get-go that there will be catastrophic failure in the network. And it was designed to deal with that failure and still operate, still transmit information. Moreover, it was assumed to be unreliable at all times. It was assumed that at all times communication will be faulty, yet the network would still operate, it would not collapse. And Paul Baran's thinking about communication network led him to the distillation of the topologies of communication networks into these three fundamental shapes, which are of tremendous importance when it comes to our thinking about information networks and about the internet. So he theorized that there are three possible topologies, right? So we have a centralized topology, which is, for example, what your telegraph or telephone network looks like, right? So if you recall the images we just saw of telephone switchboards, this is the hub in the center of the telephone network. Anyone willing to call someone else needs to go through a switchboard, In those days, it was that necessitated talking to a human operator. Nowadays, these switchboards are digitized and automated, but they are still there and they're still centralized. Then you have the option of a decentralized network, which involves a number of these, as they are called, star-shaped topologies connected to each other, right? So instead of one hub in a star-shaped topology, highly centralized, highly hierarchical, as it were, we have a small number, or a large number for that matter, forming a decentralized network. And then finally, a fully distributed network, which is the network that Paul Barron theorized, without any sort of hub, where each node can act as a hub as well. Each node can both transmit and receive, but also route information to other nodes. And Paul Barron's contribution here is that he conceptualized the value of such a distributed network. This network is what we call the internet today. And shortly after his paper was published, the concept became operational as a network in 1969. In 1971, the first email was sent. And a very important development in 1973, the birth of the TCP/IP protocol, also known as the Transport Control Protocol / Internet Protocol. What is so important about this? So the TCP/IP was proposed by two researchers, Vint Cerf and Bob Kahn. And their argument was very much in line with the original idea of Paul Barron about distributed networks and the importance of a network which has no center, which can operate when severely crippled, and which operates always presuming that something is faulty, something is going to be breaking down. So they designed the TCP/IP protocol, which is, you could imagine, the language which the network uses to communicate with other networks and therefore with itself. They designed the protocol in the following way. First, messages sent across the network, across the internet, should be divided into packets, with each packet finding its own way through the network, right? Therefore, making it far more likely that even if the network is severely damaged and or broken, the message would reach its destination, right? So each packet travels independently, messages are divided into packets, each packet travels independently through the network. The road that the packets take is unimportant, right? It's never the most efficient road. It can be the most roundabout way imaginable. The point is that this allows the packets to travel even if key elements of the network are absent. The protocol itself, TCP/IP, is not concerned with the content. Therefore, it in no way affects or limits or filters or dictates what the content of the message should be. This is really important because if TCP/IP, for example, had some sort of copyright, just to give you an example, some sort of copyright limitation built in it, the internet would never have happened. We would literally be living in a dramatically different world. But because of the way they designed it, the protocol is acts as a simple carrier and allows all sorts of messages, all sorts of content to travel. And finally, and probably most importantly, all nodes can speak to each other by definition, right? All nodes can communicate with each other, with the entire network. So following that, the internet is ready to go and it unfolds across the globe. And the final important date for us is 1991, where we have the World Wide Web appearing, which is a protocol sitting on top of the internet, allowing the rise of the web as we know it today. Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the World Wide Web protocol, who first conceptualized it in 1989. In 1990, he made it public to researchers and opened it to the open to the public at large, to the open internet, as it were, in 1991. Therefore, we are now in 2020, when I'm recording this lecture, looking at the 29th birthday of the internet. And this is the internet today. These are the submarine cables connecting distant places in the world to each other. These are the nerves of iron wire connecting the globe today. You can see how they in many respects map precisely to how the first telegraph was connected. Probably power has shifted, and you can see how the density of communication has shifted to the United States and also to Southeast Asia and China. This is the nervous system of the world at night, and this is a brilliant illustration. Some world at night collage from satellite maps, satellite images of the world, and you can see these connections. You can see the nerves of iron wire spreading across the globe. And this is how this mesh of associative trails that Vannevar Bush was theorizing looks like. This is a map of the internet from 2005. So at the end of this lecture, I just want to quickly summarize all the terrain we covered today and the most important points. So what we have so far when it comes to that journey from the telegraph to the rise of the internet and the emergence of this space we call the cyberspace is first this phenomenon of decoupling of information from matter, the ability for information to travel across vast distances, and therefore the compression of space and time, the emergence of a global information network allowing a global real-time coordination and control, the emergence of another network, the internet, which maps to literally to the first global information network, the telegraph, but allows all nodes to speak to each other, the emergence of this notion of thinking machines which can be on that network, and finally this notion of a mesh of associative trails allowing machines to map information and process it, and humans participating in that process as well. All right, if you have any questions, please hit me up on Twitter @TedMeetYou. Thank you all for listening, and see you online.